The North Coast area is facing development issues like we've never seen before, with the race to move liquefied natural gas out of BC to Asian markets, with the Northern Gateway Enbridge project to move Dilbit bitumen to Asian markets. It's putting a lot of pressure on the North Coast area, you know, in terms of transportation issues of large tankers, in terms of terminals in Kitimat and Prince Rupert. It gets back to the fact that these marine use plans that each community has are very, very important. To be able to put your community's voice forward to decision makers in government, to stakeholders, and really to the world, that we have to make right decisions, and that those decisions need time. And unfortunately, you know, those time frames do not always match up with our capacity to deal with those issues. It doesn't always match up with our community's decision-making process.
Canada is a trading economy. Our economic livelihood depends on our ability to trade with the world, and the Port of Prince Rupert is that gateway. We really see our role as facilitating and enabling Canada to fulfill its trade objectives and to keep the trading economy going. And Prince Rupert is being looked to as the solution to many of North America's and Canada's trade challenges. And as a result, we've planned for and we foresee, you know, tremendous growth. And that with that growth comes jobs. I mean, the liquefied natural gas industry is a good example. North America, British Columbia, has a lot of gas that is, quote, trapped. And the only way it has value is if it gets to international markets. And this region is viewed as one of the gateways to those international markets.
We're in the what we refer to as the estuary of the Skeena River, or the mouth. The tide runs up the Skeena River about 60 to 80 kilometers. And so basically what's happening here is it's all the mixing. It's the mixing of the fresh and the salt water, and it's just really, really, really productive in terms of juvenile salmon coming out, but also for shellfish and everything like that also.
Three quarters of harvested fish and shellfish species depend upon estuaries during their life cycle. The greatest threat to estuaries is by far their large-scale conversion by draining, filling, damming, or dredging. These activities result in the immediate destruction and loss of essential marine habitat. In and around the Skeena River estuary, major industrial developments are now proposed.
People here have a very close tie to the region, to the water itself, the marine environment. We are people of place. There are families here that go back many generations, whether it be First Nations or European. Many of us live off of the resources from the marine environment here and don't necessarily see what's being proposed as a fit for us. If government is allowed to move forward with industry in terms of how they see the future, then this will be a complete industrial site. This will be a massive industrial zone all around Prince Rupert here, the Skeena estuary, and the surrounding areas. You will have massive LNG development, you will have massive oil by rail and pipeline out of here, you will have massive coal being distributed out of here, you'll have massive everything going out of this place, but there'll be no consideration given to the marine environment around it. We stand to lose many things, but I think what is probably first and foremost in many British Columbians' minds is our salmon, the wild salmon that presently exists here. We have the Skeena River, the second largest salmon producer in Canada and one of the largest salmon producers in the world. It's untouched, it's undammed. This is an incredible piece of water with major productivity.
When I came on board, this was a little over 2 years ago, this LNG was just starting to put through applications for referrals. And on our table today, we have 19 major files associated to major activities. Not all of them are LNG, but the majority of them are. There are so many issues related to LNG that we have to address on the stewardship program. We have to address the air emissions that come out of a facility that uses 100% power from gas. There's a disposal at sea area issue here when a facility goes into site and has to remove some soil and they want to pump it back into the ocean. There's the issue with the port in establishing additional anchorages outside of their boundary lines without consulting Metlakatla. There's the issue of shipping as it relates to the potential for ships to come out of Kitimat and out of Prince Rupert.
People really want to see responsible use in terms of the environment here. They want to see sustainable industry, industry that won't affect what we presently have, so that we're building on what we have as opposed to removing from or watering down what we have. So there's a great deal of concern over that. The MAP process, the Marine Planning Partnership, I have a little more faith in terms of the ability to at least implement it because it is a smaller plan. It's really between two governments, although communities would like to think of themselves as a third level of government within that structure. Also, ensuring that that which we value the most is protected, and that's our access to the marine environment and the rich foods and tradition that it provides us.
This place is productive all year round, that there isn't really a time where it takes a break that it would be really good to do any development, is that there is, it's just important all year round for us. It's highly utilized, not only by the Metlakatla, but by a lot of the First Nations throughout the whole North Coast use the estuary here for various reasons.
They call it their supermarket. They can go out there whenever time of the season to harvest. But if there are super tankers either passing through or anchored, which could be contaminating the region, nobody's addressing it. And that's where we have to address it. So the bottom line is Metlakatla wants to be able to protect the lands, waters, and resources so that their membership can harvest in perpetuity. And that's what the stewardship program is doing, is to make sure that the children's children's children can go on, access that sockeye or that seaweed or that halibut, knowing all this industrial activity is still ongoing. And that's our plan.
In the face of all of these proposed developments, we can't ignore the fact that we still have unresolved rights and title issues with the federal and provincial governments. And really, in the end, I think that's where a lot of First Nations want to end up, with the ability to self-govern, with the ability to manage our resources as we did in the past, with the ability to determine what we want to develop in terms of an economy, what we want to protect in terms of certain ecological values, and how we want to evolve our culture.